Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak.
You made it here today because, as always, we have gathered here in the name of Jesus Christ. Glory be to God. He's alive. He lives. This week, we're going to talk about a few things that I think a lot of people struggle with. And what does it mean to give your life to Jesus Christ, to surrender your all to the Lord? And so let us start and open up with Psalm 2. This week, everything is going to be based upon Psalm 2. I got a lot of other scriptures and Bible verses that we can read and look into that kind of confirm everything that's being said here by the psalmist. And this is what it says. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now, therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice and trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way, for his wrath is kindled quickly. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. It's from that psalm, the devil tempts Jesus, right? Bow down and worship me, and I will hand to you the authority and the glory of all the kingdoms of the world because it is of mine. And that's something, you know, the devil always wanted to be was God. He didn't want to be likened unto God, but wanted he himself to be God and to be worshiped as if he was a God while living in evil, you know, never wanting to admit his sin was grievous to the Lord. You know, And I think that's something we all struggle with, you know. We want to blame the devil for everything, but never want to be held accountable for our own actions. People don't want nothing to do with the prophets, right? They don't want to do anything, nothing to do with anyone who speaks the word of God. The Bible can be very offensive to a lot of people, and then they don't want to hear about it. Don't want nothing to do with it. If they do read the Bible or come to the Bible, they see it as a weapon, and they want to use the Bible as a weapon to hurt others, to condemn others, to judge others. The devil is our accuser, always constantly trying to accuse us of not being the children of God. And is everybody the children of God? Well, I don't know. Those who are begotten of God were begotten of God not because they were born or because they belonged to certain race or genealogy of people. They belong to God because God has called them his son. Right? John says that it's not by the will of man or by the will of flesh, rather it is by the will of God. Anyone has the right to become his children. And those who are the children of God, those who have the right to be called the children of God, are those who believe in the message of Jesus Christ. Those who believe in the message. And Jesus says, this is the message, that you would abide in me and I in you, that you would follow my commands. You know, I had an interesting conversation with my friend from Uganda, or Uwanda, or wherever it is. I think it's Uganda. And we were talking. She's a very spiritual person, and has given her life to the Lord. And, you know, she was saying, you know, we must have an intimate relationship with God. That's what God seeks, is an intimate relationship with him. And from us, I said, yeah, I have an intimate relationship with the Lord. Here's what I struggle with. How do we have an intimate relationship with God when he lives in you? How can I love God with all my heart, my mind, and my soul if you're the holy temple and it's in you, God has his being and his life? In you dwells the Spirit of the living God. How do I love God while he's in you, right? That's what I struggle with. Well, I gotta love you in order to love God. And that's what Jesus did and said, this is the prayer. We see it there in the Gospel of John. Jesus saying, this is the prayer, that as I am in you and you are in me, Father, that I would be in them and them in me, and that we all would be one. Not separated, but one. Them and me, and me and them. That way we can be together. Wherever it is I am, we could be together in that. And Christ did it so that we would love one another. So that in loving him, it would motivate me to love you. And the only way I could be motivated to love you is to love him. And together we all love one another. See, God is love. And you say, well, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Am I to love my neighbors, right? love my neighbors as I would love myself, and or wished for them to love me. But who is my neighbor, right? Those who hate me and despise me, those who refuse to acknowledge me, you know, those who refuse to love me, care for me, or tend to my needs, right? What about those neighbors? What about those who have made themselves my enemy? And you know, that's Jesus, right? Hanging on the cross, saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. And yet, while Jesus was walking this earth, while Jesus was walking in this world, he walked under the curse, because cursed is he who is hung from the tree. So, and we are asked to follow him, to imitate him, to carry the curse, to walk under the curse, you know. And we demonstrate the love of God. We love those who will not love us back. And that's what God does. That's why do the nations rage, and why do the peoples plot in vain? You know, we're gonna display the love of God no matter what that means. They dispersed their bonds apart and cast away their cords, right? Let's look here at Jeremiah chapter 5, as Jeremiah was dealing with the same thing. Those who don't believe are going to reject Jesus Christ, and they most certainly not only reject Jesus, they're going to reject you. And they reject you because they have rejected Jesus. Jeremiah chapter 5 says it like this. Run to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem, look and take note. Search her squares to see if you can find a man who does justice and who seeks truth, that I may pardon her. Though they say, as the Lord lives, yet they swear falsely. O Lord, do not your eyes look for truth? You have struck them down, but they felt no anguish. You have consumed them, but they refuse to take correction. They have made their faces harder than rock. They refused to repent. You know, I see that in a lot of people's life. And I've seen people, including my brother-in-law, my sister's husband, be completely consumed by the delusions of his own imagination, and in that be completely punished day and night, and being tormented day and night to the point where can no longer believe in the truth, has no idea what the truth is completely confused, frustrated, and upset. Because for him, there is no truth. Everything is a lie. And he has no idea how to regain control over his life or the things around him, because everything and all control is being taken away. And is completely tormented. Now, I also know from a sister who struggles with alcoholism, and I hate talking about the truth, and I love my sister, and there's nothing I desire more than to see her conquer the alcoholism, and it takes support, and we need to be good support for her and surround her with a solid support system, which I think there's a few people around her that struggle with that, struggle to see what good counsel is, and struggle to see the support she needs, and how that support comes from us, the people who love her. And that's something I want to see throughout all the church and everybody who comes, especially here to our Father's House of Prayer, that they would find a support system in the gathering of believers. Something good. You know, when we say we give our lives to Jesus Christ, what does that even mean? Give your life to Christ. And we'll get into that as we go. Nobody gives their life to the Lord. Raise your right hand and repeat after me. And this is one of the most grievous things that's going on across the United States of America right now. As you raise your right hand, repeat after me, Lord, forgive me of my sins. I believe you. I believe you exist. And I repent, right? And have no clue what it means to repent, never change, never do anything different. That they are just another person of the world. They are truly what they are American citizens, and have no desire to leave their citizenship of America and become an Israelite, a person who is God-governed and surrenders their life to the authority of King Jesus, our King, our King. No, they just go on doing what they've been doing. You know, won't take or accept correction. I've seen through my sister and my brother-in-law's struggling marriage that neither one on either side are willing to accept any sort of correction right now. And I pray and hope that one, if not both, would find this thing that, you know, the problem is with me. The reason she drinks and does these things is because of all the abusive words I choose to use. There's not an ounce of love within me. I'm abusive, I'm destructive. I use my words to tear down, to break down, to destroy, to slander, to tear apart. That's why I drink. And then one of the things is the reason I'm so upset and angry and want to tear down and destroy and break down is your love to be drunk. Your love to be with somebody other than me. Yet, and both of it, both of them, both sides of it all, neither wants to accept the accountability or the responsibility of their own actions, of what they're contributing in. Then I said, these are only the poor. They have no sense, for they do not know the way of the Lord, the justice of their God. I will go to the great, and I will speak to them, for they know the way of the Lord and the justice of their God. But they all alike had broken the yoke. They had burst the bonds. Therefore, a lion from the forest shall strike them down. A wolf from the desert shall devastate them. A leopard is watching their cities, and everyone who goes out of them shall be torn in pieces, because their transgressions are many. Their apostasies are great. How can I pardon you? Your children have forsaken me and have sworn by those who are no gods. When I fed them to the full, they committed adultery and trooped to the houses of whores. You know, that's the thing, is adultery. We could have spiritual adultery, be cheating on the Lord by finding our comfort, our help, our guidance from some other source than the Lord, from some other source than the justice and the righteousness of God's word. Do I agree with divorce? And now that there's no divorce, instead, why don't you work to become better? And then at what point do you say it's absolutely failed and broke down and there's no recovery? The only thing there is left is divorce. Well, that comes from the hardening of the heart, the fact that love has ultimately died. And there is no love. Somebody who loves you is not going to break you down, tear you apart. If they love you, they are not going to abuse you. They're not going to slander you or tear down, break down your reputation. Instead, love builds up. It encourages. It will protect your reputation by being silent during those times when you had every reason to judge, condemn, or speak about the failings of another person. And, you know, I see it a lot with a lot of husbands and wives, of how wives do not have any honor for their husband, their husband's decisions or things of this nature, and husbands have no honor for their wives or their wives' decisions. You know? A lot of times it's just about who's in control. And so long as I'm in control of paying the bills, I'm in control of the income, I'm in control over what's for dinner, and I'm in control of this, I'm in control of that, I want to be in control of everything. When we give our life to Jesus Christ, we're surrendering that control to Him. It's what some would say, a higher power, to a higher authority. And how do we surrender that control? We put the teachings and instructions to work because we believe in the process. We believe in the authority that comes from the teachings and instructions. And that's what it means to surrender to the will of the Lord. Not my will, but the will of the Lord. A lot of people who commit spiritual adultery will seek help from mediums and psychics and wherever, tarot cards, palm reading, some other thing of chance, and yet that's all lies, and there's no God in it. They can't give you any advice, marriage advice. They don't care about your marriage. Usually those kind of people care about one thing, and that's your money. They care about your money, and that's what they want from you. You want courage? Here's a crystal, courage crystal. Put this courage crystal in your pocket and carry it around with you. There's courage. You want love? Here's love crystal. Put this love crystal in your pocket. Carry it around with you. $19.95 per crystal. And really, that's all they care about is your money. And you know, how silly is it to think carrying a rock around in your pocket is going to do something good for you, or they're going to produce something good? Other people use AI is their source of everything. The source of wisdom, the source of knowledge. And they go to it for the answers of everything. But don't come to God in prayer. Don't recognize the power of prayer, the power of talking to God, the power of having an intimate relationship with God. We want intimate relationships with people, with their husbands, with their wives, but we don't want to have an intimate relationship with God being in the midst of our relationship. You ever sat down and just, husband, I'm going to pray for you, and prayed for them while you were standing there out loud? As a husband, have you ever prayed for your wife out loud while she's there? I'm going to pray for you. Praying together. Praying for God to come into your life. Now we go to secular counseling. Go see a psychiatrist, go see marriage counseling, whatever it is. But the last place we go to find help is church. They were well-fed, lusty stallions, each neighing for his neighbor's wife. Shall I not punish them for these things, declares the Lord? Shall I not avenge myself on a nation such as this? It's one thing. One reason I think a lot of marriages fail in the United States of America, we base our relationships upon what we see on television, what we see on the internet. You know, we will talk bad about our wife who's struggling with alcoholism, and you're always drinking and you always want to hang out with your drunk buddies, and yet never acknowledge that you're watching porn while nobody's around. You're wanting your wife to be just like your neighbor's wife, or your friend's wife, or your co-worker's wife. Judging your wife as according to what they're doing. Well, I wished I had a wife like her, like his wife. That's the problem with you. You're not like her. And we wonder why the marriage is destroyed, and why is it failing, and why are people frustrated, and why is it that the imagination or the delusions of their own imagination are spinning and spiraling so far out of control, I no longer know what the truth is. I have no capability of believing in the truth, even if I knew it was the truth. I'm constantly in a state of torment. That's God punishing you. Go up through her vine rows and destroy, but make not a full end. Strip away her branches, for they are not the Lord's. For the house of Israel and the house of Judah have been utterly treacherous to me, declares the Lord. They have spoken falsely of the Lord and have said, he will do nothing. No disaster will come upon us, nor shall we see sword or famine. The prophets will become wind, and the word is not with them. Thus shall it be done to them. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of hosts, because you have spoken this word, behold, I am making my word in your mouth a fire, and his people wood, and the fire shall consume them. Behold, I am bringing against you a nation from far, afar. O house of Israel, declares the Lord, it is an enduring nation, it is an ancient nation, a nation whose language you do not know, nor can you understand what they say. Now, a lot of people who are Pentecostal people say, oh, that's God speaking about those who speak in tongues. And no, it's not. No. He's speaking about the Gentile nation who was able to receive the Holy Spirit and then come to the people of Israel and speak to a language they did not know. And what was the language they did not know? What was the language they could not hear? What was the language they could not see nor understand? The language is the Word of God. The teachings and instructions of God. And then the Gentiles received it. The Christians received the Holy Spirit, was transformed by the Spirit of God, writing upon their hearts his laws, his ordinances, his statutes, putting within them a new spirit, taking away the heart of flesh, the heart of stone, and putting within them the Holy Spirit. A language of love. A language of discernment. A language of encouragement. A language that builds people up. And that's something that they couldn't recognize. It's something they couldn't understand because they were so full of anger. They were so full of frustration. They were so full of lies and deceit that they were just lost in the whirlwind of life, being tormented day and night by things that weren't even real, weren't even happening. Their greatest fears were becoming a reality because they believed in the lie and the deception and instead of the truth. Their quiver is like an open tomb. They're all mighty warriors. They shall eat up your harvest and your food. They shall eat up your sons and your daughters. They shall eat up your flocks and your herds. They shall eat up your vines, your fig trees, your fortified cities in which you trusted. And they shall beat down with the sword. He was, at that time, Jeremiah was talking about Babylon coming in, taking over everything and taking away their control. And Babylon is that Babel, a place of confusion. We see today and now that the Christian nation, the Israelite nation, the people who recognize Jesus Christ as King, as Lord, as Savior, as God. They come out like mighty warriors. And the sword they carry is the Word of God. Because they know it can save you. It can save your marriage. It can save yourself from yourself. But you have to admit, you have to be willing to give your life to Jesus Christ. And many people don't recognize or understand even what that means. But even in those days, declares the Lord, I will not make a full end of you. And when your people say, why has the Lord our God done these things to us? You shall say to them, as you have forsaken me and served foreign gods in your land, so you shall serve foreigners in the land that is not yours. declare this to the house of Jacob and proclaim it to Judah. Hear this, O foolish and senseless people, who have eyes but see not, who have ears but hear not. You do not fear me. Do you not fear me, declares the Lord? Do you not tremble before me? I place sand as the boundary for the sea and perpetual barrier that it cannot pass. Though the waves toss, they cannot prevail. Though they roar, they cannot pass over. But this people has a stubborn and rebellious heart. They have turned aside and gone away. They do not say in their hearts, let us fear the Lord our God, who gives rain in its season, the autumn rain in its spring rain, and keeps us the weeks appointed for the harvest. Your iniquities have turned these away, and your sins have kept good from you. For wicked men are found among my people. They lurk like fowlers lying in wait. And they set a trap. They catch men like a cage full of birds. Their houses are full of deceit. Therefore, they have become great and rich. They have grown fat and sleek. They know no bounds in the deeds of evil. They judge not with justice. They cause the fatherless to make it prosper, and they do not defend the rights of the needy. Shall I not punish them for these things, declares the Lord? And shall I not avenge myself on a nation such as this? You know, that's why marriages fail. That's why relationships fail. You don't recognize or understand that you're the temple of the Lord and that you cannot love God without loving each other, loving one another, and coming back to the things that began the relationship, which was love and respect, care for one another. You must recognize and understand that God is love. And to give your life to Jesus Christ, I remember 2012, when I finally gave my life to Jesus Christ. And to give your life to the Lord means nothing else matters but the Lord. Nothing matters. Nothing is important but Jesus Christ. Nothing is important but God. And I remember giving up everything in my life for the gospel, and the sake of the gospel, for Jesus Christ, and the sake of Christ's love for the world, and had to be all in, 100% all in, not lukewarm. But all in, not standing on the fence, all in, not one foot in, not one half in, all in, surrendering my life to Jesus Christ. Here I am. This is me. Do what you will with it. Not my will. I surrender my will for the will of God. And you can take me and do anything you so desire with me. Here I am. Use me. Here I am. Whatever your will may be. And that's what brought us here to our Father's house of prayer. That's how we got here. That's how I got here. By surrendering everything. No longer have need for money. I don't care about money. I don't care if I can pay my bills. I don't care about work or any of the things and the benefits that come from work. One thing matters and nothing else matters. Jesus Christ. One thing matters and nothing else matters. The gospel. Your salvation and another person's salvation. People lost. People hurting. That's what matters. the things that matter to God then mattered to me. Nothing else. Surrendering my life, and you say, well, I'm going to do this. I've been there, did it, you know. I'm going to write a book and write down my experience and write about how to obtain salvation and how to be transformed and all the things that we got to do by faith, through faith, and come to believe in and all this stuff. And then that's still my will. And maybe it is the will of God that it's, God says it like this, that, hey, I have somebody sitting in prison that needs to be talked to. And that's who I want you to talk to. And you say, well, how am I going to get into prison? And God says to you, don't worry, I have a way. And I will send you in that way. Maybe God says, I want you to talk to somebody in this town or this community or this place. And you, I don't know how, I don't know what I'm going to do. God says, I have a way, and I will get you on that way. We have to surrender to the will of God. And if God says to you, I want you to tell the world, I am coming. Then you surrender to it. Not worrying about, can it be done? How is it going to be done? What to do? And not just surrendering to the will of God and allowing him and saying, I have a way, and I will send you down that way. Nothing matters but Jesus Christ. And if nothing matters but Christ, then you would recognize and understand God is love. And that's what matters. Love. Because God is love. That's what's important? Love. Because anyone and everyone who is absent or void of love has become bankrupt. And God saying in Jeremiah, and God saying there in the Psalms, and even in there in Job, we'll get there in tomorrow or Thursday, and some of the book of Revelation, you know, that without love, we have nothing. And these are my people. These are my people. And Jeremiah is saying, these are the people of the Lord. These are the people of God. And yes, God will discipline you. And yes, there will come a punishment for abandoning God. But he will not completely destroy you. He will not completely break you down. He will not completely make an end of you. Because he loves you. Because he loves you. And usually that's the determining motivation that gets people to change, that transforms people from being an alcoholic to a non-alcoholic. That's usually what restores the sanity of a person who's being tormented by the delusions of their own imagination. What is important? And I pray love is the most important thing in your life. And there may come a time when you have to recognize and you have to say and you have to admit that love has died. Love has died. And if love has died, what do you do? Where do you go from there? That's something we should think about over the next couple days.
What's important to you?